For hundreds of years, the ancient Israelites had a series of kings. Many of these kings were selfish, wicked men who led the Israelites into military and spiritual defeat, sometimes even worshiping false gods. But a few of Israel's kings followed God and helped the people live according to God's ways. This often led to times of great prosperity for Israel. These kings used their wealth and power to make sure that all Israelites were fed and cared for. One of these great kings was a man named David. As a boy, David was a shepherd who tended flocks of animals out in the fields. This was sometimes a very dangerous job, as David had to fend off lions and bears in order to keep his flock safe. Later in his life, David put these skills to use by becoming a fierce warrior, leading Israel to victory in many battles. The people of Israel loved David, and they eventually made him their king. In each season of his life, even in times of failure, David interacted with God in a deep, personal way. In fact, David's love for God was so great that he was described as a man after God's own heart. As a shepherd, warrior, and king, David also wrote poems and songs called Psalms that were open and honest prayers to God. David expressed sadness, fear, and even anger towards God in these Psalms. In one Psalm, David used a metaphor that was very personal to him to describe his relationship with God. "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever."
Good morning and happy Labor Day weekend to all of you. I gotta be honest. I'm blessed this morning. I didn't expect to see but about half this many on this last holiday before Thanksgiving. So, wow. Thank you, guys. This is great. The last 2 weeks, just not that we're big on keeping track of numbers around here, all right? But I will tell you, the first 2 weeks of the kickoff of this new series has been phenomenal. The last two Sundays have been the largest crowd since Easter, and the two biggest Sundays in a row ever, okay? So that has been awesome, and it might not be damaged much today, all right, by being a holiday weekend, but this is awesome, so thank you for being here. If you are visiting New Hope for the very first time, we are so delighted you would come and be with us. There are visitor cards in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to fill a card out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. We make a promise, we will not beat on your door, we will not bother you on the phone, but through the mail, we want to let you know all that we possibly can about New Hope, where we've come from, where we think we're going, and what happens on a weekly basis here. So if you'd fill that out, drop it in, please do so. Regular attenders and members, you know those cards there also for you to get prayer information or announcements or messages to staff. So please don't be bashful about using those either. Let me highlight a few announcements and a couple of prayer requests, and then a few introductory remarks about where we are in our Belief series, and then we will get engaged in our worship today. This coming Saturday, first Saturday of September, September 6th, men's breakfast here at the church. Special guest speaker, one of our own members, but you've never heard from him before. His name is Al Gould. He's in our 8 o'clock service most Sundays. Many of you got acquainted or got a little information about him back during rodeo month. Al Gould is a world premier saddle maker and leather worker. We had a couple of saddles on our stage. I'm glad we had good liability insurance. They were worth over $10,000 apiece. He has sold saddles for $15,000 all around the world. He is a master craftsman and an artist, and he's going to share a bit of his story on Saturday. On Saturday, if you were there, you can buy raffle tickets and have the opportunity of getting your very own handcrafted leather engraved Bible cover or a belt, all right? My suggestion is get whichever has the most leather, okay? For some of you, it'll be a belt, all right? But anyway, that's going to be this Saturday morning, 8 o'clock breakfast, coffee's ready at 7:30, and there's his picture, all right? Well, there was his picture, all right? Next Sunday, after the 10:45 service at about 12:15 over in the Murbach building, our homeless outreach will be taking place. They will prepare about 100 or so sack lunches and other giveaways to share with those who are in need. If you've never done it, please do it once. It's worth doing at least one time. Get the experience. Know what's going on. And some of you may be motivated to do it on a very regular basis like others are. On Sunday, September the 14th, Mike Cousineau is going to be in town, and he'll be with us. We'll highlight him briefly in all three of our morning services. And that night, we're going to have a 1040i gathering here. If you want to find out more about our mission trips to Africa, you want to find out what God is doing through 1040i in Morocco, then we're going to have about a 45-minute to an hour session with Mike Cousineau that Sunday evening. So come and join us. Lindsay Eccles has also put a list of supplies that the 9 or 10 of us going to Africa in February can take a suitcase full of supplies each. And so we hope you'll bring the list that's on there. There are baskets out in the pavilion that you can put those in on Sundays, or you can drop them off during the week in the office. Please read the insert, or the, I should say not the insert, but the blurb that is in the bulletin about Widow to Widows, all right? October 6th, Lynn is going to be launching a new ministry and outreach in our church for women who have been widowed. This, it can be from any stage in your life, but it's probably most applicable to recently. She found out in the loss of her own husband that there are things she didn't know he did around the house. And she has no idea how to take care of them. And so she has put together a list of things and some resources that would be available, and that sometimes if you do things together rather than alone, it's not near as frightening. And so this is a new ministry that Lynn is launching here at New Hope, and that kickoff is on the evening of October 6th. And she'd love to have you come and join her. Save the date for October 24th. It's going to be a Hope Fest out in the parking lot of the church. New Hope, New Covenant, Mountain View, and North Park are going to share the stage with their worship teams and have an evening of worship. And there will be food booths and there will be tables. And it's kind of our own Woodstock, all right? New Hope's version of Woodstock, all right? But a chance for us to cooperate with other churches just for the purpose of sharing life together and reaching out to the community. So you'll hear more about that in the weeks to come. And the children's musical drama rehearsals are going to begin. You've got that in the bulletin, and there's posters all around the church, so please take note of that. A few updates on prayer requests. Terry Fletcher's son, still, he's home from Stanford after the removal of his eye. There's a couple of more surgeries left to go, and then, of course, the prosthetic eye will be necessary. But where he's really struggling right now is, my life is finished. It's over. It doesn't have any value anymore. So please be praying for Terry's son. Wanda Wood was in church this morning after 2 weeks of chemo treatment. She's handling it very, very well, so we're grateful for that. Ozzy is in church this morning. We prayed for him the last 2 weeks, recovering well from his knee replacement surgery. Sharon Phillips hopes to see me today, but I didn't expect it. She had surgery this week at Clovis Community, and she is doing well in her recovery. Vita Bond from our 8 o'clock service is struggling with a lot of health issues right now. We had a celebrity in our 8 o'clock service. We got to go back in history, though, for some of you to know that he was a celebrity. He was the last athlete at Fresno State to letter in both football and baseball. And he also went on to play for the Atlanta, okay? And his name is Bobby Glazebrook, all right? He was part of the Stinging Bees defense back in the late 70s and early 80s. The Glazebrook clan, David and his family are in our church. They're having a family reunion today. And so Bobby came out and his wife from South Carolina. So it was great. I knew all the Glazebrooks before any of them knew Jesus. And it's been exciting to see almost the entire family come to know the Lord over the years. So that's exciting stuff. If you are joining us today, you are here for the second lesson in a series that will take us 31 to 32 weeks to finish. It's called Believe. We're going to be looking at 30 key principles out of the Bible. The first 10 are the key truths of the Bible. Doctrine, what we build our life on. It's important. The next 10 things are the practices. Once we become part of God's family because we believe the truth, we become part of His family and His church. What are the practices that are going to bring about spiritual maturity and spiritual growth? And then the last 10 things, what are the 10 key virtues? What is it that God wants to produce in us as we mature in Him? And so we'll be looking at the 10, 10, 10. Out here in the pavilion, all right, up towards the gazebo end, you will see a wall of truth. It looks like a brick wall. And the 10 key truths are on that wall. At any point in this study where you can say, I believe all 10 of those, go write your name on it. This is church-ordained graffiti, all right? Go put your name on it. I had a text after last Sunday's sermon, and one of the guys from our church said, Pastor, when I read that list a week ago, I didn't think I would ever be able to sign it. But just after the first message on God, 3 of my 4 problem issues have already been cleared up. I'm almost there. I had another text from a guy who said, you know, Pastor, I already signed it. But after I heard last Sunday's sermon, I'm wondering if I was a bit of a hypocrite. I believe those things, but I don't live those things. So I might put an asterisk by my name. And I had to respond to him. I said, we're not looking for perfection. It starts with belief. Knowing your areas of weakness are good, and God can work on that. But what do you believe? Once we know what we believe, then our life can begin to match the truth in which we believe. So take the opportunity to read it. There's pens out there. You can sign your name. We'd love for you to do that. There are children's take-home papers. So if you have kids or grandkids in Sunday school, they'll be bringing take-home papers. They're getting the same lesson over there at their level that you are getting in here. And have some dialogue with your kids and grandkids about those various things. We've got a sign-up sheet to come around. There are 2 things on the clipboard. The top one is Grief Share. It went around last week. Several people are going to sign up. It starts September the 10th on a Wednesday night at 6:30. If you've been through a recent death or loss in your family, this would be a great Bible study and support group for you to participate in. They need to know you're coming so they have enough materials. The bottom page is for women's Bible study on Tuesday night. That is going to start on Tuesday, September the 9th. And they are going to be studying 2 Corinthians on Tuesday night. So if you are one of our Tuesday night women who want to study the Bible, put your name on there and your contact information. Again, that's so they have enough information. We're going to do our very best not to talk as fast as we did last week. And we're going to try to not go quite as long as we did last week. But if I slow down, there's no promise. All right? We'll just do our very best. I'm going to save a little bit of time by doing something right now. And I don't know if Milo told you to get this one ready because I didn't know when I was going to do it. You're looking at me like, no. Okay. All right. That's all right. I was going to put these 5 books up on the screen, but I'm going to show them to you. And if you want to do some more reading, screen. Do what? Oh, all right. It's under the PowerPoint stuff. But there are some books that if you want to do some more study on your own, these are some of the references I'm doing to prepare for these first few Sundays. All right? And so let me highlight a couple of them, and I'll try to do them in order that's up there. There's a book called God Forsaken. This is written by Dinesh D'Souza, and the subtitle is Bad Things Happen. Is there a God who cares? Yes, there's proof. This fits in perfectly with today's study. I will tell you, he has 2 PhDs. Okay? And I'm only telling you that, and that is he uses 4-bit words quite frequently. All right? This is a thinking study. Very well done. All right? Very, very well done, but challenging, but it's good on the subject that we're looking at today. We need to find room for 3. All right, room for 3. Got right there. Third row, 3. It works perfectly. How are you today? You look wonderful. Good? Good. And we won't embarrass your daughter. All right, but you're just embarrassing. I mean, what can I say? All right. For the guests, they are not visitors, okay? So I would never do that to you, all right? Your first week here. God Forsaken, all right, is the first one. Next one. This is a great book on doctrine. I know that title doesn't jump out and sizzle for you, but if you want to know what are the key truths and what does the Bible have to say about those, What Christians Should Believe by Driscoll and Brashears. This is a lot better reading than the book I had in Bible college and seminary, okay? In terms of it's very readable, but it's also right on the money. All right, so this is one I would also recommend. The Trinity, and we didn't get time to talk about the Trinity much last week. I'm going to deal with it for a few minutes at the beginning of today's sermon. The best reading I have ever read on the Trinity in a concise way is done in a book by Chuck Colson called The Faith. Look, that's not a very thick book, okay? But it's challenging, all right? Our men's Bible study is doing it on Thursday mornings right now, but the section on the Trinity in here, so if that's something you struggle with, this is one I would recommend to you. And then Ravi Zacharia wrote a book called The Cries of the Heart, Bringing God in When He Feels So Far. And again, this is connected to the idea that we're going to be looking at today, the personal God. And the one I've given away, I keep giving this book away, but it's Lee Strobel's The Case for Faith. So those would be some additional things I would recommend to you if you were struggling with any of these things as we are talking about them in this first 10-week portion of Believe. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. I believe you're going to be learning a new song. No, is this, this is not a new one?
We had to
change. Oh, we had to change. All right. We learned a new one last week, and it's been in my head all week. Want to take an idea what it was? God's Not Dead. Yeah. We learned it last week, and it was awesome. You guys did terrific. Oh, we got the ladies today. We're going to have a good offering then. You all always give more when the ladies wait on us. So thank you. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, we love you. We thank you for life today and the opportunity to worship you. Our Father, last week we looked out of your scriptures. We looked out of history and science. Father, we believe we have plenty of evidence that you exist. That the activities and the efforts and the energies and the desires and the affections that are demonstrated by millions and millions of people around the world every Sunday morning and many other times in between support that you exist, that you were a God who is and are and always will be. But God, though you are great and you are awesome and you are powerful and incredible, you also care. And you're compassionate, and you're loving, and you're intimate, and you want to be personal. And Father, just as it's possible for a husband and a wife to live in the same house and not communicate very well, and just as parents and kids can go through the adventure of a week and rarely speak to each other, it's possible for us to have you as our Lord and Savior and to live as if we don't know each other. And for that today, I trust some of us are saying, I'm sorry. Thank you, Father, for your unbiting, for your always available, for your unconditional love for us. Thank you, Father, that though we ignore you, sometimes you never ignore us. You come at our faintest cry. So, Father, I pray as we grow and learn more about your word and about who you are, that we will have a desire to be more intimate with you because your desire is unbelievable in how intimate you want to be with us. Our Father, there may be a man or a woman, a young person who's walked in the church today and they feel unloved and unlovely. They feel like life isn't worth living. I hope before this morning is over that they will discover, though the world may treat them bad and though sometimes family treats us as if we are strangers and sometimes the circumstances of life just dump more on us than we possibly can bear. There is a creator, eternal God who cares about them and desperately wants a relationship with them. So give us clarity of speech and wisdom in our thoughts that's only fueled by the power of your Spirit in our presence today. We give to you out of joy, and we want your name to be exalted in all the earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ken Davis is an author and a speaker. And Ken Davis tells the following story in one of his books. He says, in college I was asked to prepare a lesson to teach in my speech class. We were to be graded on the creativity and the ability to drive home a point in a very memorable way. The title of my talk that day was The Law of the Pendulum. I spent 20 minutes, Ken said, carefully teaching the physical principles that govern a swinging pendulum. If you don't know what the law of the pendulum is, let me summarize it for you. A pendulum can never return to a point higher than the point from which it was released. Because of friction and because of gravity, when the pendulum returns, it will fall short of its original position. Each time it swings, it will make less and less an arc until finally it is at center rest. The point of rest is called the state of equilibrium, where all the forces acting on the pendulum are now equal. I attached a 3-foot string to a child's toy top, and I secured it to the top of the blackboard with a thumbtack. I pulled the top to one side, and I made a mark on the chalkboard where the first release point was going to be. I let it go. Each time it would swing back, I would make a new mark, and it took less than a minute for the top to completely come to rest. When I finished the demonstration, the markings on the blackboard proved my thesis. I then asked all the students in the room, "How many of you believe now the law of the pendulum is true?" All the classmates raised their hand, and the teacher raised his hand. The teacher started to walk to the front of the room thinking that my lesson was over. But in reality, it was just beginning. You all have had that experience here before. Hanging from the steel beam in the middle of the classroom, I had prearranged a large, crude, but functional pendulum. I had gotten a 250-pound ball of weight. I tied 4 strands of 500-pound test parachute cord to it, and I had it hanging from the middle of the room. I invited the instructor to climb up on a table and sit in the chair with his back and his head right against the wall. I then went and got that 250-pound ball that was at rest in the middle of the room, and I swung it up to within just a hair's breadth of his nose. And I said, "I am now going to release this ball. And if the law of the pendulum swing is true, you have nothing to worry about. It will not hit your nose." Do you believe the law of the pendulum? The teacher, with a bit of a shaky, weak voice, said, "Uh-huh." And so he let the pendulum go, and the pendulum swung all the way to the other side. It made this big swishing sound as it paused for a moment at the top, and it headed back towards my teacher's face. And you have never seen a man move so fast as he leaped from his chair and got out of the way of the swinging pendulum. I then asked my classmates, "Does he believe the law of the pendulum?" And the students answered, "No, he does not." Here's the question. Do you believe the eternal God of the Bible is the one true and living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and this is a God who cares about you? It is one thing in here to say you believe it. It's another thing out there in your life to live like you believe it. The teacher could say, "I believe it," when he sat out in the room. But when he sat on the chair and had to prove the truth of that truth, he wasn't so sure. Are we? The Creator God of the Bible always has been. The God this Bible talks about, the God who wrote, maintained, preserved these scriptures, says about himself, "I am an eternal God. I always have been. I always will be. I am the forever I am." The Yahweh God of the Bible is not, as we found out last week, he is not the only God that exists. But he is the only God who has always existed. In fact, this one God who always has been, in his own writings, he warned us to have no other rivals but him. He tells us there are other gods we can serve and worship, but he wants nothing to do with us if we have anything to do with them. We looked at what some of those rivals and who some of those rivals were. If you remember that last week, by the way, if you're new here and you missed last week, go to the website this week, watch it. This is important, guys. Not because I'm preaching such great messages, but this subject matter and what you are reading here week by week. By the way, accountability time. How many of you read chapter 2 before you got here today? Look at that. God bless you. How many will read chapter 3 before you come next week? All right. Good, 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 good. Keep it up. But you see, it's kind of like if you got a heart specialist and you need heart surgery, would you want him missing the sessions on the heart? No. If you got a guy that's going to pour the foundation of your house, would you want him to miss the part on how you mix cement? Probably not. So these first 10 key truths are absolutely essential for the health and spiritual growth of our lives. We don't want to miss one of these. And if you have to miss a Sunday, go pick up so that there's no gaps in your foundation. So last week we looked at who some of the rival gods were out of the Old Testament and New Testament and even in contemporary times. What I want to briefly do today is just talk about, first of all, where do these rivals come from? Where do these other gods, besides the eternal God of the Scriptures, where do they come from? I suggest to you they come from three sources, and all those sources lie within each and every one of us. These rival gods that vie for our affection, our attention, and our worship, first of all, come from our own human imaginations. And they come from there usually as a result of our own fears and frustrations. They also come from our own self-exaltation. Because of pride or our own delusions, we have this line of thinking and reasoning. And number three, out of human selfishness. We have an overpowering lust and desire to have more than what is good for us. And how do these rivals express themselves when they are originated out of our own imaginations, exaltations, and selfishness? I believe these rivals express themselves when they come out of our human imagination through things like mythology, a place to blame our misfortunes of life and a way to condone our unholy lifestyles. Go watch Hercules. You want a little bit about mythology? Go watch the new movie on Hercules. Hercules is a star. I went and saw it. I loved it. I had great fun. All right? I grew up watching all those. They haven't warped me, but that's a personal opinion. I see them as fantasy, and it was actually pretty PG, all right? But go watch it. You see, the Romans, they came up with these gods because they had to have an explanation to the people why bad things happened to them. They also needed to have a reason why they could have so many wives. If Zeus had a lot of wives, then it would be okay for them to have a lot of women, okay? Nothing wrong with it. So we create these things out of our human imagination. We come up with mythology because we want our gods to be distant and disconnected, and that gives us a place to put blame and to appease our own guilt. When we create gods out of our own self-exaltation, we end up with people who have a Messiah complex. People like David Koresh and Jim Jones, okay? And they get followings to follow them. Sometimes it can be leaders of nations that have Messiah complexes. I'm not talking about ours, but, you know, sometimes that happens. And then selfishness. We're misguided and mismanaged. Desires and priorities in our life create a selfishness that we love our stuff. We love our money. We love our job. We love our homes. We love inordinate love. Okay? An overpowering lust and desire for the stuff and the things more than God. All three of these, and any other source where rivals might arise in our life to influence us, God deals with this problem in the first two commandments of the Ten Commandments. All the other eight commandments deal with very specific and yet different issues, but God deals with this God matter in the first two commands. If you didn't get it right the first time, he wants you to get it right the second time. And so he talks about it. First, he says, "You shall have no other gods before me." All right? None at all. Any exceptions?
No, all right? But if you didn't get it right the first time, he says, second command is, you shall not make for yourself any idol in the form of anything in heaven or on earth or under the earth. You shall not bow down nor worship them. So what God is telling us in his first two commands of the original Ten Commandments is no gods of any kind made with your hands or by your heart. I would have a difficult time, I have to acknowledge, I would have a difficult time putting confidence in a God of human origin when I could trust a God who is the origin of all human life. If I have a choice between the two, which one makes greater sense? Now here's a declaration last week that God wants us to make. The key idea of last week's sermon was, I believe the God of the Bible is the only true God. He is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That's number one out there on the wall. Throughout the Old Testament, there is a clarion, clear call for the belief in the oneness of God. The Shema, which is the Hebrew word for hear. Anytime you would say, hear, O Israel, that was, hey, pay attention, wake up. This is important, what I'm about to say. And so God, through Moses, says, hey, wake up, Israel. Hear the Lord our God. Here's what he has to say to us. The Lord our God is one God. That's on page 15 if you want to read it in the Believe Scriptures. It's also found in the book of Deuteronomy 6, verse 4, and Mark chapter 12, verse 29, as Jesus quotes out of the Old Testament. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is how many gods? One God. One God. The idea stood in radical contrast to all the other religions of the day. All of Israel's neighbors had multiple gods, each with their own influence, limitations, and petty self-interests. But God, the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are one God, three persons. This is often considered to be mysterious at best and self-contradicting at worst. Yet, as we turn the pages of the Bible and get to the New Testament, the names of what seem to be three deities emerge, each declaring to be God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. These three are mentioned and appear throughout the Old Testament era, but their distinctive identity and presence invade the life and times of the New Testament again and again and again. Though the Trinity is not a word explicitly used in the New Testament, this idea is made abundantly clear. Jesus explained the Trinitarian nature of God to his disciples at a time of great crisis for them. It was late in the ministry of Jesus Christ, not long before his betrayal and his crucifixion, when his followers remained confused about the mission that Jesus had come to accomplish. You see, they thought Jesus had come to be the president of the United States. King of Israel. That's what they thought. They thought he had come to get everything right in their world, to overthrow the Romans. It would be like the Democrats wanting to overthrow the Republicans, or the Republicans wanting to overthrow the Democrats, all right? It was as if they were at odds with each other in Israel. These disciples said, Jesus, I thought you come to take over. They were confused. You see, they didn't understand that Jesus didn't come to take over, Jesus came to die. They didn't understand he didn't come to sit on a throne in the heart of Jerusalem. He came to occupy their heart, the seat of authority that governed their own personal life. Why? Because he's a personal God. He's not a politician who sits in a White House. He's not a politician that sits on a throne of a kingdom. He is a God who wants a personal relationship, being given the right to sit on the throne of your life and mine. And so they come to Jesus, these disciples, and they asked Jesus for some reassurance, because they thought that at any moment they could be arrested and executed. And they wanted Jesus to assure them that the commitment they had made to him was a confident commitment. In response to their question, Jesus gives them a Trinity answer. They wanted to see the Father. They wanted to know the Father was in on this. And so Jesus says to them in John 14:9, those of you who have seen me have seen the Father. If you've seen me, you've seen him. Why? Because we are one and the same. John 10:30 says, I and my Father, we are one. He goes on to say in John 14, 16 through 17, Jesus promises that the Father will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth, the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything that I have said to you. The Father and Jesus would come to live within them in the person of the Holy Spirit, just as the Father lived in the Son and the influence of the Holy Spirit. Now, they all would come to live within us, and we would have true peace. Jesus used the Trinity to reassure his own closest associates. The biblical revelation throughout history discloses this Trinitarian nature of God in a long prepared historical sequence. Go all the way back to the beginning. In the beginning, God created. God the Creator in Genesis, present at the birth of creation. Then you stroll ahead from Genesis, the beginning book of the Old Testament, to Matthew, the beginning book of the New Testament, and you will see Jesus, God the Son, at the beginning of the New Testament. Why? Because here is the birth of the Messiah. And then you will see in the beginning of the book of Acts, the Holy Spirit coming down from above at the birth of the church on the day of Pentecost. The New Testament is clearly Trinitarian in its witness. In Luke chapter 1, verse 35, we have the birth of Jesus described to us, actually described to Mary, before she was ever pregnant. The Holy Spirit, the angel said to Mary, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy Spirit, who's the Most High? God the Father, that's the Most High. The Most High and the Holy Spirit will come upon you for what purpose? So that God, the Holy One, the Son of God, can be birthed in you. I'll explain right there. Then let's take it a step further. Jesus' birth, Jesus' baptism. We see all three simultaneously playing a role in the work of redemption. This was so important that Matthew recorded it, Mark recorded it, Luke recorded it, and John recorded it. All four, not a gospel, missed it. They included this. At his baptism, the scripture says, as soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water, and at that moment, heaven was opened. A spirit of God in the form of a dove descended, alighting on him, and a voice from heaven. Who's the voice? God the Father. How do we know it's God the Father? Because he said, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased. And then we also see the Trinity expressed in the Great Commission of Jesus. So at his birth, at his baptism, and at the Great Commission, in Matthew 28, 19, some of Jesus' parting words to his closest disciples said, go into the world, baptizing them. In what name? The name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And yet, when we say Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, God made it very, very clear there is one God and only one. Paul's benediction, the key verse from last week was 2 Corinthians 13:14. Paul addresses the three persons in one sentence when he says, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We have this mathematical equation. It's a formula that doesn't make sense to us, but it makes sense to God, and that is what is important, folks. 3 equals 1. 1 equals 3, and throughout church history, clarity developed on this. It is the church in the second century that came up with the term Trinity to describe this 3 equals 1. Christians embraced the doctrine and have for over 2,000 years as a bedrock of their faith. And just a side note, do you want to know the methodology that Islam uses to entice Christians away from their Christian faith to Islam? They use the doctrine of the Trinity. Because they don't believe it, and they say you ought to be able to understand God, and so they have God as a singular person at different times in history, and they work away at this doctrine of the Trinity in the lives of people on college campuses and in prison. I had a talk with a chaplain about 7 months ago, and he said, we sometimes will lose Christian believers because they don't know the doctrine of the Trinity, and they get pulled away by somebody who can explain their view better than they know theirs. It's important, folks. You might be thinking I'm splitting some theological hairs with this next illustration, but hang with me for a moment. The Bible tells us we are created in the image of God. And I believe part of that image of God is reflected in the view of the Trinity as community. Go back to Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 2. God said, let us make, not God, let us make man. Do you ladies mind if I say humanity? Because it's counting y'all too, okay? So let us make humanity in what? Our image. Did God have a mouse in his pocket? He said our. Let us make man in our image and in our likeness. So God created humanity, mankind, in his image, in the image of God. He, who he's just said us and we, now it says he made us male and female. He created them. Let us make them in our image, and they're one like we are one. The original small group, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The one true God created humans in the image as a community. Look again at these verses just briefly. The image of God is in Adam and Eve together. Not as separate beings, but Eve came out of Adam. They are distinct persons, yet addressed individually. We are told that God told them to... See, God gave to Adam and Eve directions for them to give to their kids, and they said, a man should leave mom and dad, cleave to his husband and wife. And God told Adam and Eve, you tell your kids, two shall become one. Our true nature is like God. We are not only created for community, but on our original design, we are a community. We are, therefore I am. Of course, our unity as community was fatally injured when Adam and Eve sinned. Selfishness versus otherness now reigns in our flesh. And this makes it difficult to grasp our intended nature. This is why Christ came to restore us. When we enter a relationship with God through Christ, we are placed into one what? When we come into a right relationship with God through Jesus Christ, we are all placed into one body. Thank you. Thank you. Paul used the term body here. All right. We are one body, many parts, but one body. When we are husband and wife, two become one in marriage. The Bible says that Christ is the bridegroom and you and I are the bride. And when we are united in him, the two now become one. All the principles of the Bible, Jesus said, can be placed in one sentence, two thoughts. Love God with all that you are and love your neighbor as you love yourself. It is in relationships that we reflect the image of God. I invite you to rethink the phrase, love your neighbor as yourself. As the Father loves the Son, and the Son loves the Spirit, and the Spirit loves the Son, and the Spirit loves the Father, and the Son loves the Spirit, and the Father. They are one. Love your neighbor as yourself. Why? So we can be one in God's design. The one God who reflects relationship in his own nature, Father, Son, and Spirit, wants to be engaged in a very personal relationship with you. He is not only an eternal God, but he is a compassionate one. This compassionate God warns us, have no other gods before you. Why? Not for his benefit. God does not need us. God wants us. God has chosen to be personally engaged with his less than perfect, fallen, self-willed, rebellious, and sinful creation. He persists in reaching out so that we can be engaged personally with him. Once we decide that the God of the Bible is the only true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the next question, the question that begs our attention for our last 20 minutes today, is this eternal God good? Is he good? How good and how personal can God get, and how good and how personal will we let God be? We sang about it in the last song. He's personal because he knows our name. That's better than I am with you some Sunday mornings. I've been known to call people the wrong name. God never does. He knows your name. God not only knows all about us, but he will never forget us. He keeps an account, and this is an ever-updating account he keeps with us. The Bible says he knows the number of hairs on your head. Ladies, he also knows the real original color as well. God promises through Isaiah chapter 49, verses 15 and 16, can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion of the child that she has born? Though she may forget, I will not forget you, this God who cares says. I have engraved your name in the palms of my hand. Do you know what he's talking about? This is the book of Isaiah. That is a prophecy about the crucified hands of Jesus Christ. It is in that crucifixion that this personal God does good for you and for me. He saves us from ourselves and our sin by his crucifixion. He did not do that for his benefit. He did that for our benefit. So the key question, is God good? Contrary to the opinion of some, God does not have to be good to exist. After witnessing a human tragedy, some people have concluded, I don't believe there is a God. No God would allow bad things to happen to good people. And you know what I always marvel at that logic in this part is? Is you know what? When great things happen to bad people, or when great things happen to good people, we don't ever say, wow, God must be great because look what he did for me. We only get mad at, see, that's why we create these mythical gods in our head, is because we want somebody to blame something on, rather than often accepting the blame for sometimes much of what bad happens to us. The Greeks and the Romans embraced the religion of paganism. The pagan gods in no way felt obligated to be good. If it were to turn out these gods were true gods, it would be unwise to deny their existence, the pagans thought. Their followers worshiped these pagan gods in an attempt to appease them in the mere hope that these gods would not pick on them. But the one true God of the Bible that's revealed in the scriptures, he doesn't have to be good. But it turns out when you study this book, he is good. He desires to have a good personal relationship with us. There are at least two things that God is not. God is not uninvolved in creation with no plan. That is fatalism. That line of reasoning suggests bad things happen in our world because there is no God and there is no plan. Or if there is a God, he doesn't give a rip about what's going on in this world, and neither should we. Their theme song is Que Sera, Sera. Whatever will be, will be. This is the same philosophy behind the famous early 80s bumper sticker. Stuff happens. I edited that slightly for church consumption today. God also is not involved in creating, yet uninvolved in our lives. That's deism. Adherence to this way of thinking suggests bad things happen in our world because God created the universe like a cosmic watch. He wound it up, turned it loose, and then doesn't care anymore what goes on. On the contrary, when one reads the Bible from beginning to end, here is the declaration God invites us to make. It's the key idea for chapter 2. I believe that God is involved in and God cares about my daily life. Let me ask you a question. When you woke up this morning, whether by your alarm or just by your own natural internal clock, when you woke up this morning, you put your feet on the side of your bed and you looked up and you looked out, did you say, wow! This is the day God has made. I'm glad and I'm going to rejoice in it. Wow, I can't wait to get to church because God, who loves me so much, I can't wait to let him know how much I love him. God, what do you have in store for me today? Did that come close to characterizing any of your attitudes this morning? Oh, I had a boy. Dan, yeah? Or did you get up and say, oh, crap, I got to go to church again? See, our view of God, this eternal God that is, this eternal God who cares and wants to be personal with you, ought to make a difference. The psalmist said on page 26 in Believe, and page Psalm 121 verses 1 and 2 in your regular Bible says, I lift up my eyes to the mountains, and where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the one who is the maker of heaven and earth. The psalmist is saying the one who created it all has enough interest in me to pay attention. The writer's in a deep valley, and he's in need of help. So where does this guy look? Where will his help come from? And the psalmist says, he will look up to the one who created the majestic mountains, who then most assuredly has the ability to lift him up and set him above the lowly places in which he now finds himself. I believe it may be the very same psalmist who said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because the one who creates the mountain and the valleys is with me, and he will not abandon me. Why? Because he cares about me. Consider these three key concepts. You say, Tim, you'll never finish this. Yeah, we will. I want to give you a tip today. A tip. Okay? T-I-P. Okay? Three things about God that transform our relationship with him. Number one, God is transcendent. That's the T in tip. Number two, God is immanent. That's the I in tip. The P, God is providential. Now, just a quick question. How many of you in a sentence this past week used the words transcendent, immanent, and providential? Probably not terms we use. So let me define those just briefly. All right, number one, God is above us. That is transcendent. He is beyond all possible human limitations. God is great. God is good. God is awesome. He is above all. He's around all. He's in all. He's not bound by any of our circumstances or events that may control us. He has created it all. Therefore, he has complete authority and the right to do what he chooses. So why does a God who has everything care about me, Tim McLean Rowland, rapidly approaching 60 years of age, living in Clovis, California? Why does he care about me? This is the same question the psalmist posed on page 30 in Believe, or Psalm chapter 8, when the psalmist said, "When I consider your heavens and the work of your hands, the moon, the stars which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of us, human beings, that you care for us? You have made us a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands, and you put everything under their feet." As hard as it is to grasp, the answer is simple. The reason God did that is because he cares about you. He cares about you. Just a few examples out of the Bible that God cares. When Adam and Eve sinned, when they messed up, how would you like to have been the one who messed up perfection? I mean, God has just said, this is good, this is good, this is good. And then he does Adam and Eve, and he says, this is very good. And then you messed up very good. That's Adam and Eve. Did God care? You bet he did. The scripture says he came and walked in the garden just as done every other evening. And he said, Adam, Eve, where are you? Did God not know where they were? Of course he did. That's why he was standing right by the bush they were hiding behind. He wanted them to know where they were, and maybe God wants you to know today where you are in relationship to him. They were hiding. God found them hiding in the garden. And you know what God did? God did something that day he had never, ever done before. He became a tailor, and he made clothes. The scripture said, he made them garments to cover their nakedness. And if you keep reading, you will discover in a couple of chapters, which covers a significant period of time in their lifetime, God lets Adam and Eve know he's not finished with them, and he will give them a fresh start. They were disciplined. They were kicked out of the garden. They now had to labor and toil. They had to experience pain and childbirth. But I think most moms could tell you that the pain in childbirth is not near as great as the pain of a rebellious child. If you happen to be a child, think that one through. They went through that with their first two born sons, Cain and Abel. Cain killed his brother Abel. And you might say, wow, they didn't have much left. They had a son and he was a murderer. The good son was killed by the bad son. God said, I'm going to give you another son. His name is Seth. And if you jump from Genesis chapter 3 and you go to Matthew chapter 1, you will find Seth's name in the lineage of Jesus Christ. God cared. And God gave to them what they needed in the midst of their pain. When the world was disgustingly evil, beyond imagination, did God care? He said, I want to destroy it all. Did God care? Yes. He looked and he searched and he found Noah. The scripture says Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And he gave a sinful world a fresh start.
When Goliath intimidated the children of Israel in the valley of Elah, did God care? Yes. He sent a shepherd boy to encourage a king to slay a giant and to rescue a nation. When a woman arrived at a well in the middle of the day, she arrived at that time for a specific reason. She was ashamed. She was disenchanted with life. Every man she had ever known had hurt her and abused her. And she went for the solitude to meet a need. Did God care? Absolutely. God the Father directed God the Son to go to a well in the middle of a day alone. Had the disciples still been with him? Because, you see, Jesus sent him into town to get supplies. Had those other men been with him, that woman would have never showed her face at the well because too many men. But one man hanging at a well. And before she can turn and walk away, Jesus says, "Could you give me a drink?" And a conversation ensues where Jesus tells her about all of the junk in her past. And he says, "You might give me a cup of water that will satisfy my momentary thirst, but I am prepared to give to you a kind of water where you will never thirst again." Did God care? Yes, he did. And that lady ran back and told the whole city, and revival broke out. God cares. When Peter failed and denied the Lord three times in one night, did God care? Absolutely. When that rooster crowed for the third time, Jesus looked at Peter and said, "I haven't forgotten you." That was not a look of indictment. That was a look of love and affection. "I haven't forgotten you, Peter. I'm not through with you yet. I cared when Adam and Eve failed. I cared when the world failed. I cared when the armies of Israel failed. I cared when a woman failed. I care, Peter, about you." And Jesus was crucified and buried and rose again. And then Jesus offered Peter an invitation to breakfast. Do you know what Jesus asked Peter? "Peter, do you care? Peter, do you care?" The Gospel of John says it this way. Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me?" Once each time for the betrayal. "Do you love me? Do you love me? Peter, do you care about me? Do you care about others? Do you care about my plans? Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. I'll give you a fresh start, Peter." Three chapters in the book of Acts, guess what? Peter stands up in the city of Jerusalem and the biggest revival in the world takes place, and the world has never been the same since. Sir Winfield Grenfell, medical missionary in Labrador, found himself adrift on an ice floe, headed out to sea. He mercifully killed his dogs, made a coat out of their sides, put up a distress flag, and he laid down and went to sleep. The point of equilibrium. Pendulum had swung both ways. Now he was at rest. When they picked him up, they woke him up. They said, "Why are you sleeping? Weren't you afraid?" And he said, "There was nothing to fear. I've done all I could do with what I had. The rest laid in God's hands." That is trust in a transcendent God. Number two, God is near. That's what imminent means. God is near. He is indwelling. Okay, I got 7 minutes. Imminent means within the limits of knowledge and experience. While God is transcendent above the fray of everything, he chooses to come live within us. He comes to dwell amongst us. He stoops to our level. He wants to be where we are. Our great God is able to draw near, to love, and to care. The writer of Psalm 121 says, "He will not let your foot slip. He watches over you while you slumber, but he never sleeps nor slumbers." Once we accept the fact that God wants to care for us, we often are still left to ponder, how does he have the capacity to do so? There are millions and millions and millions of us. This was fascinating. Randy Frazee is a runner. Eric, you're a runner, right? I never really understood runners who ran more than 10 seconds at a time, all right? But I understand. Do you have this app called Runkeeper? Okay, there is a smartphone app. It's a smartphone app for dumb people who run. I'm kidding, Eric. I'm kidding. This app tells him how far he's run. his average time per mile, his overall times. It also shows him an overview map of exactly where he has been. If you looked at the history on that app, you would see maps of beaches and mountains and all kinds of locations of terrain. Even more amazing, Runkeeper not only tracks Randy Frazee and his locations, but it does that for about 10 million other people who have that app on their smartphone. And it's taking care of all of that simultaneously. Is it really much of a stretch to believe that a transcendent, immanent God can track 6 billion of us if a smartphone app can take care of 10 million? But here's the deal. God goes farther than that app. That app doesn't care one bit about you, Eric Olson. It doesn't care how far you run today or if you never run again. It doesn't care. It's just there if you want it. But God cares. Matthew 28:20, God says, I will be with you even to the end of your age. Colossians 1:21, God has chosen to make this great mystery known. What's the mystery? Christ in you, the hope of glory. This transcendent God who's out there also is an immanent God in here. And last of all, God has a plan. This transcendent, immanent God has a plan, providential plan, carefully plans and provides for our future. Page 32 and Believe, Psalm 139, verse 16 in your regular Bible. Your eyes saw my unformed body, all the days ordained for me written in your book before one of them came to be. The plan God is working out for those who trust Him and follow Him is good. The Apostle Paul assured us of that in Philippians 1:6 when Paul said, I am confident of this one thing. Paul said, I do believe in the law of the pendulum. I'll sit on the chair with my head against the wall, and I will let the rock of this law swing in my direction. I am confident that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion. Romans 8:28, we know that the all things God works for good to those who love him. These verses are just as true for you and me today as they were for Paul then. Here's the key application of this key idea. What difference does this make in the way I live? How can believing this truth about God being personal and good not only be true in our minds, our understanding, but also in our hearts, the way in which we live? One, God's ways are higher than ours. We can now have an upper story perspective of lower story living. Chapter 4 in this book, or Isaiah 55, 8 and 9 says this, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. So which ones are you going to trust, his or yours? It depends. If you believe that he is the one true living God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and he cares about you, then you will believe his thoughts more than your own. You'll make a garment, wrap up in it, and fall asleep on an iceberg because you can trust him. We are tempted to make frantic decisions because we can't see our way out. We can't see around the next bend. God's ways are higher than ours. He's seated above the throne. When we feel that we don't understand God's instruction, his word, we must remember he's these things above and we don't. Two, God who created nature and history knows and cares about us. Matthew 6, page 38 in chapter 2. Jesus himself says this, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you eat or drink or what you wear. That's what the pagans do. But don't you worry, O you of little faith. Don't say, what shall we eat or drink? Don't you know that your heavenly Father knows you need them? These words about a loving Father paint a vivid personal picture of a God who's not out to get us, but rather to redeem us and rescue us. He doesn't want to destroy us. He wants to restore us. We don't live a worry-free life because we can quote the scriptures. We live a worry-free life because we trust our Father. And the only way to trust him is to know him. God is working out his good plan for our lives. Philippians 1:6. He has a good work and he will finish it. So what do you believe? Do you believe God is good? Do you believe he's involved and cares about your daily life? If the answer is yes, then stay in the chair. Don't bail out. Do you believe in the law of the pendulum? The law of God is greater than the law. Can you put your name to the fact I believe God is involved in and cares about my daily life? Let me close with this. A terrible storm came to town. local officials sent out an emergency warning that the riverbanks would soon overflow and flood the nearby homes. They ordered everybody in town to evacuate immediately. A faithful Christian man heard the warning and decided to stay put. He said to himself, "I am going to trust God. If I am in danger, God will send a divine warning to me." The neighbors came by his house about an hour later and said to him, "We're leaving. There's room in our car. Come with us." The man said, "I'm trusting God. He will save me." As the man stood on the porch watching the water rise up his steps, a man in a canoe paddled up to him and said, "Hurry, come on, I got room in my canoe. The waters are rising quickly." But the man said, "No thanks, God will save me." The floodwaters rose higher, pouring water into his living room, and the man had to retreat to the second floor of his two-story house. A police motorboat came by, saw him in the window, and said, "We'll come up there and rescue you." And the man said, "No, don't bother with me. Save somebody else. I have faith that God will rescue me." The floodwaters rose higher and higher and higher, and the man had to climb onto the rooftop. A helicopter spotted him, dropped a rope ladder. A rescue officer came down the ladder, pleaded with the man, "Grab my hand, I'll pull you up." And the man refused, and he said, "No, thank you. God will save me." Shortly after the house broke up, and the floodwaters swept the man away, and he drowned. When in heaven, the man stood before God and said, "Hey, I put all of my faith in you. Why didn't you come and save me?" And God said, "Son, I sent you a warning. I brought you a car. I provided a canoe, and I sent a motorboat, and I even had a helicopter land on your roof. What more were you looking for?" God has, I believe, probably revealed himself to you again and again and again that he cares. The question is, how personal do we want to be with God? The scripture tells us how personal God wants to be with us. But how personal do we want to be with God with every single thing in our life? Our Father, you know where each of us are in our relationship with you. And I know the same is true for every one of us. You want to take us to the next step in a relationship with you. Wherever we are, there's a next step. We are never perfect yet, but you will stay with us until you complete the work that you started. So wherever we are, you want to take the next step with us. I trust some of us are thinking, are we prepared to take the next step with you? You care. You've given us history. You've given us the scriptures. You've given us your Son. You have given to us the Holy Spirit. You have given to us so much to let us know that you care. You've given the warning. You've sent the car, the canoe, and the boat. There may be some here today. This is their helicopter opportunity. I trust, Lord, some are saying, "Lord, I'm ready to get personal with you." Teach us, Father, what you want us to know. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week. What chapter next week? 3. All right. If you don't have a Believe book, they're available out in the pavilion.